Mascara topped up, stilettos at the ready, then you're in the right place for 45 minutes of sunshine-filled Riviera escapism. You and I are cut from the same ice. Sincerity made us the perfect heist. Burning all the gold to sapphire skies. But the breeze is cold in paradise. Was it love? It was wild. Brought me to my knees. Spark of fire, spark of wars. Welcome, Sky VIPs, to this very special virtual night celebrating the premiere of Riviera Season 3, brought to you by Sky VIP and Grazia. I'm Rosamund Dean, Grazia's deputy editor. Now, the temperature's dropped and the nights are drawing in, but it's not time to get out the slippers and loungewear just yet, because in just a few minutes, we'll be chatting to some of the amazing cast of Riviera and showing you some exclusive clips from the new series. But first, here's a little reminder of where we left the viewers at the end of Season 2. I'm a pagan of the good time. My lover's in sunlight. Keep the goddess on my side. See the mantle sacrifice. Drain the whole sea. It's something shiny. Something needed for the main course. It's a fine looking high horse. What you got in the stable? We've a lot of starving faithful. That looks tasty. That looks plenty. What a cliffhanger. Well, Georgina must be okay, as I'm delighted to welcome the star and executive producer of the show, the gorgeous Julia Stiles, all the way from Vancouver. Hi, Julia. Hello. How are you?
Hi. Very good. How are you? Thanks for having us.
Oh, thank you for joining us. So what time is it there in Vancouver?
About 9, I want to say. It's the morning.
In the morning. Oh, well, good morning. Good morning to you. Nighttime here. Also joining us tonight are Poppy Delevingne, who plays Daphne, and Claire Hope Asherty, who plays new character Ellen Swan. Hello, both.
Hello.
How are you?
How are you
doing? Are you two both in rainy London?
Yes, indeed.
Doggy in London.
Yeah,
thank you so much for having us.
And it wouldn't be Riviera without an endless supply of high fashion outfits. So I'm delighted we'll also be getting the inside scoop from the costume designer of Series 3, Rebecca Hale, who's in Venice tonight.
Hi.
Rebecca, how are you? Hello. And how is Venice?
Venice is as marvellous as it always is. Same fabulous light and bright sunshine and wonderful food and endless canals and decaying buildings. It's fantastic. We're just about to go into Acqua Alta, so I think we've had a bit of, well, we are wearing gumboots occasionally, so, but it's fantastic.
Wow, amazing. What an international gathering we are tonight. Last but not least, we have three Sky VIP competition winners joining us who will be posing their questions to the Riviera team. So hello to Helena, Anne and Emma. Lovely to have you on board.
Hi.
Hi. Hello. How are you all?
Hello there.
Well, we'll be chatting to you a bit more later on. We also want you at home to be involved. So if you pre-submitted a question, listen out for it. If not, there's still time to get involved by asking your questions through the chat box. And remember, if you're watching on a mobile device, you'll need the YouTube app to join in. So do it now. If you're sharing your thoughts on the new series or your Riviera-inspired outfits, don't forget to use the hashtag SkyVIP on all social posts. Now, Julia, hello again. We are delighted and relieved that you got series three in the can before lockdown. How close to the wire was it?
Down to the wire. We literally wrapped Monday the 10th or something, and March 13th was when lockdown started. And there were a lot of people on the crew who, British crew, who had planned more of a vacation to explore Buenos Aires and more of Argentina. And I think the producers had to corral them and tell them to go home because it was the last flight out of Dodge.
Wow, that's crazy. I didn't realize it was that close.
Yeah, we finished just in time, luckily.
Yeah, yeah. Now take us back to 4 years ago when it all began. What first appealed to you about the role, the character of Georgina?
I could only read the pilot script, and the producers gave me an idea of where the show would go. But aside from the setting, which, not just for lifestyle and being able to travel to these beautiful parts of the world, I thought it was a great premise for a show to have the idea behind every great fortune is a great crime, and that the Riviera is a sunny place for shady people, that to have this beautiful setting that's so glamorous, but underneath it all, there's a lot of corruption and toxicity. But then the character of Georgina, I just was really impressed with her seeming naivete, but that evolves into recklessness, where she just, despite all the things that are heaped on her, she runs straight towards the danger. She doesn't, you know, hop on a plane back to New York and run away from it. So I thought there was a lot of potential there. I didn't really know where it was going necessarily, but so when I think, when you say 4 years ago, it just, I feel so lucky to be part of a show that has evolved and grown so much and gotten bigger and better.
Yeah, and now you're an executive producer on the show. So what does that mean in terms of how it all works?
Well, really, I just wanted to be an executive producer so I could see scripts earlier in the process. I'm very lucky that all three seasons of Riviera, the producers and directors had been very collaborative and open to my input. I just wanted to formalize that this season.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, Georgina's character arc is quite something. She's completely reinvented herself this series, hasn't she, Georgina Ryland?
Yes, she's taken her maiden name back. She's trying to, as you saw, she literally burnt the house down. She's trying to distance herself from the Cleos family and move on with her life, and forget about her past and the things that she's had to do. But then she's working at the Courtauld Institute in doing art restitution, or teaching about art restitution, and in walks Rupert Graves' character, Gabriel, and offers her a much more adventurous, exciting job that she can't resist. And so off they go to Venice.
Yes. Yeah. Rupert Graves plays a very interesting new character. We have a clip here. Here's a clip with Rupert, who plays your new, shall we say, colleague.
Do you ever think about keeping the name Cleos just for work?
That's not who I am anymore.
No, but opens doors.
You want my name to help you open that door?
No.
Any sign of it?
No.
Wow. So that's a scene from the first episode of the new series. Can you explain what's going on there, Julia?
Well, they've gone to a fancy party in Venice with the secret agenda to recover this stolen Picasso. and they're snooping. Snooping as they are searching for the Picasso that they're supposed to be looking for. I can't really say much more than that or what happens next, because it sets the whole season in motion, but I don't want to give it away.
No. Poppy, let's come to you next. You play Daphne, of course, who's back this season. What makes Riviera the escapism we all need right now?
Well, I mean, it's like traveling from your sofa, really, isn't it? You know, you're transported to these incredible locations. You've got Venice, Buenos Aires, obviously the south of France, with all the glitz and all the glamour, and of course, you know, the drama that comes with that. You kind of get lost in it. And yeah, I would sort of describe it as pure escapism, you know, without any effort from the viewer or the audience.
Which is ideal at the moment.
Yeah, it is. I feel like we all need a bit of that. We all need to feel like we can escape.
Yeah. So at the end of season two, we left Daphne reeling, having just found out her twin is a murderer. So here's a clip of you with your twin, Nico, and a first look at your new lover, Dario.
Oh, what's wrong?
I think she knew I was digging. I mean, it wasn't pleasant.
Because you're sentimental and sloppy. I should have known you'd f*** it up. Stay away from her, she's no good for you.
One more drink?
She'll have water.
Interesting dynamic there. So how's Daphne's relationship with her brother now?
How long have you got? It is, I would say, very complicated, to say the least. You know, he has a hold over her that she can't seem to escape from. And now what she knows about him, it's kind of unearthed this darkness within her. And even though, of course, she loves him and she's still very loyal to him, she is very much aware of how controlling and toxic he is.
Yeah. So what can we expect from Daphne in this series? Is she going to surprise us?
Well, I feel like in season two, the sort of vibrant, charming Daphne, everything, there's been a bit of a change up. And season three, you kind of get to witness her demise and you see how fragile and vulnerable and, you know, potentially dangerous she's become. Will she surprise you? Yes, she'll surprise you. She'll also shock you. But I guess just like many of the other characters in Riviera, you know, we're also changeable. You can't trust anyone.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm so aware of spoilers. Don't want to give too much away.
I know. No, never.
You were recently a guest on Grazia's podcast, sharing your life advice. Absolutely brilliant. Yeah, was it fun to do? Thank you so much.
With the lovely Rhiannon. I mean, eventually I feel like we could have chatted for years, months, days. And she was brilliant. And it was such a treat and such an honour to be a part of that.
Oh, there is some excellent life advice on that podcast, I must say. If everyone do download it wherever you find your podcasts, it's worth a listen.
Good. I'm glad you agree.
Claire, coming to you next. You are, of course, a newcomer to Riviera.
Yes.
So Ellen Swan is your character. She's quite a mysterious character at first, seems to be kind of connected with everyone. So let's take a look at when you first meet Georgina.
Well, no one saw that coming.
Hi. Hello.
Ellen Swan.
Gabriel Ashley. Georgina Ryland. Different surname, not married. Barely even like each other.
So, are you the police or Interpol?
No, we're art restitution. Is experts too strong? Yeah, no, I'm going to go with experts.
And were you targeting Mr. Alaperti?
No. We just follow the work. You know, it helps to know who the players are. I could tell you all about it over a drink if you're interested.
That sounds lovely, but I'm here on business. It's nice to meet you both.
And you.
He's such a charmer, isn't he? So what can you tell us about Ellen without giving too much away?
Without giving too much away, that's a difficult bit. I think much like Poppy said, of all the characters, Ellen is complicated. And, you know, that would be putting it mildly. And I think, you know, she goes on this incredible journey over the course of the season. And I think undertakes a change that even she didn't see coming, but she is confident and complicated and fierce and driven. And you throw that into a bowl with so many other women in this series who are the same thing, and it makes for very interesting results.
Yeah, yeah. And there are some amazing women in this show. It's one of the things I really love about Riviera. Were you a fan of the show before you joined the cast?
I hadn't seen it until I had a meeting about the third season, and then I watched the first and second season over the course of about 10 days, which was intense to say the least. But it was very, very intense, but it was nice to go on that kind of roller coaster where everyone, every single character makes you feel something, and you feel one way about a character one episode, and then the next episode your allegiances change and your loves and your hates change. And I mean, I was definitely exhausted after 10 days, but it was good fun.
That's a real immersion experience.
Definitely.
So how did the other cast members make you feel welcome?
Oh, well, there were quite a few new cast members, to be honest. So it was, some new kids and some old kids. And it was just such a nice family. It can be nice being away on location anyway, because you're kind of forced into this family. It's like kind of like going on summer camp, really. And people either gel or they don't. And they really gelled on this job. And we had such a fun time hanging out together and having meals together and working out together. Poppy and I went on holiday together with other people. It wasn't a romantic getaway, which I also wouldn't mind. But but just spending time and replacing the family that people miss when they have to be away from home, which can be really important to not feel isolated.
Yeah, of course. I love the idea of it being like summer camp. Where did you go on holiday together?
When we were in Buenos Aires, we went to Iguazu Falls, which are the waterfalls up north.
Wow.
And they were beautiful, and it was gorgeous weather, and yeah, it was great fun.
Oh, that sounds incredible. Okay, so we're going to talk fashion. There's still time to ask your costume related questions through the chat box, so do that now. And of course, share your Riviera inspired outfits on social media using the hashtag SkyVIP. Along with the fabulous locations, the gorgeous outfits are a huge part of what makes Riviera unique. Rebecca Hale, costume designer for Riviera 3, welcome.
Hi there.
What were your thoughts and feelings when you got the call about this job?
I was extremely excited because I had previously watched both seasons before that, and I love the south of France, and I love the clothes, and I love fashions, and I love Julia's acting. So I just thought, wow, that this is exciting.
Yeah, I mean, it's incredible. And lots of, when people talk about the fashion in Riviera, they often talk about the women mostly, because they normally get the best outfits, but the men have wardrobes that are just as well considered. Can you talk a bit about how you use fashion to create a mood or build a character? I think we have some stills of Dario.
Here
he is.
Well, yes. Well, initially, what you do is when you get the job, you think of each character arc, and then you talk to the director and the producers about how they want it to go. And actually, with Dario, I had a very different idea, and Chris Tickier, the producer, wanted him to look more classic and use tailors like Laura Piana, Cifanelli. So it's that sort of rich tailoring that you get with people that are living in the south of France, and Boglioli, and I can't remember how you say it, Cuccinelli. So I had a very different idea, and then we had to sort of, so I initially did a fitting, and then Chris said, no, I see it in a different way. So I said, fine. And I was in exactly the right place because we're in the south of France. So I just trotted along to Laura Piana and did some shopping with him, really.
How lovely. Oh, it looks so chic. And then at the other end, there's a new character, César. Talk us through his look.
Well, that shirt he's wearing actually is by a brand called Endless Joy that I thought was pretty apt for César. So he's there's a duality because I actually have two sons, and one is quite straight and the other one is less straight, and so I sort of fed off that a little bit, and I just pushed it. I sort of pushed him a lot more. And whereas Dario's colour palette is a lot more subdued and classic, César is, you know, a lot younger. He hangs out in discos, he goes clubbing. He has a completely different kind of lifestyle. He's much more of a sort of open-hearted hedonist.
Loves a medallion.
Loves a medallion.
Can't do up his shirt.
No, loves an FB or a watch, you know. So everything is sort of much more acutely sort of out there.
Yeah. So
understated is Dario and César is overstated.
Yeah.
And he just likes the chaos. He really sort of, you know, everything he gets into is completely chaotic, and it's and so I sort of wanted to bring that out and use sort of younger designers for him.
Yeah, perfect. Julia, what can you tell us about César?
About César?
As a character.
He's a challenge to Georgina. He becomes her nemesis in many ways, and somehow he gets under her skin, which is a hard thing to do, I think. But they meet in Venice and have what starts, you know, their dynamic throughout the whole season is quite a cat and mouse game, or a bit of a standoff. You know, she'll be trying to take him down for most of the season.
You're in trouble if Georgina's trying to take you down, I think. Rebecca, back to you. What is your process for designing what each character wears? Where do you begin?
You start doing mood boards. I mean, with Riviera, I knew we were going to be... I didn't know about the script. I knew that it was going to be in Venice, Saint-Tropez and Argentina. So you sort of, I sort of look at colour palettes for each country, and like for Venice, I saw a lot of fashion editorial, and it was a lot of the crumbling terracotta backdrops and the Catholic Church. And so I sort of thought Baroque, I looked at Baroque paintings, and then I happened to be sort of looking over fashion mood boards, and I saw Hailey Bieber wearing this Gucci dress, which I loved. And I put that in the mood board and during the interview process. And then Julia ended up wearing it actually for the episode one. And then like with Saint-Tropez, you look at all the lifestyle. I was influenced very much by the 60s films and Mick Jagger and all the Rolling Stones hanging out in Cap Ferrar. And I didn't know much about Argentina. So I looked at South American films and TV series is like Narcos, and that was a lot more. I sort of thought of mahogany in terms of colours and old wood, and again the Catholic Church. So that's, and you sort of build from there.
Yeah, that's so interesting how all the locations play into the wardrobe choices. And in this
If time is of the essence, what you do is you look at the location, and then you sort of, I make these little boxes, and you sort of make the location in terms of colours, and then you plonk a sort of a photograph of each actor and you put them within it. I mean, on this occasion, a lot of the times with the locations weren't locked off, so you couldn't do that. But in an ideal world, that's what you do, so you make it work. And with Venice, we had three dresses potentially that we could use for the first scene. And I said to Julia, because she was going to the Palazzo to look at the location, I said, I'd love you to choose because you're going to feel it. And I think she chose the right one.
Oh, amazing.
That's so
interesting,
though. I'm now remembering in hindsight, you know, there is a bit of luck and things work out. But what was interesting about that Gucci dress that I wore in Venice is you have to commit to wearing an outfit that is going to be in the entire episode and partially into the second episode. So it's a lot of screen time. So, and it has to be, I have to be able to run in it. I have to be able to fight in it. There's a lot that happens in that dress. So picking that dress is quite a commitment. And I remember we were actually going to go with a different dress, a Roland Marais dress initially. And we wanted to say, we love the Gucci dress, but we wanted to save it for Argentina because we thought the color palette would fit better in Argentina. And ultimately, we had to make a judgment call because we were filming the Venice scenes in August and September, and we weren't going to go to Argentina until January or February. But we pulled the trigger, and thankfully, Bex chose the Gucci dress, and it worked out really nicely. But there's nothing worse than going on set and regretting the choice. I'm glad we audibled it, as they say.
Yeah. Did you have to have several different versions of that dress?
You had repeats.
How many bags? Like,
we actually only had four repeats. So I went and met Julia in New York, and this dress I put on my mood board, and I was obsessed with it. And it was a dress from 2 years ago, or 3 years ago now, in 2017, and I knew that there was a very strong likelihood that there weren't going to be many of them. And so then I rang my fixer up in England and I said, you've got to find these dresses, phone Milan, phone everywhere. And I flew back from New York and I literally landed. And she said, you've got two dresses. You need to go to Bicester Village now. And I got off the plane onto a train, totally jet lagged, and arrived in Bicester Village, huge queues. And there was this lady taking it off the hanger. I said, no, you can't have that. It's mine. I've had it put aside. I've emailed. No, I want it. I said, no, sorry, it's mine. And there was this sort of little altercation, but it was all cool.
The glamour, who knew it was? There was a scuffle at Bicester Village. The Gucci dress.
It was my worst nightmare.
I especially love, what shoes were you wearing with that dress? Because I love how you took them off to run through Venice, but held onto them tightly the whole time. What shoes were they?
They were from Reese, actually, and they were mules. It was it's a high sandal and it's got a slightly conical. I love it because it's, you can put them on and off quickly, and it's got a fairly thick heel, so yes. Anyway, you spent most of the time barefoot though, didn't you, running along?
Yeah, held onto those mules though.
The funny thing about that dress too is that you do have to pick something that's timeless, because I remember when we fell in love with that dress and we're trying to convince everybody else that it was the right one to wear, the question, we said, you know, this is the it dress. And the question was, well, is it going to be the it dress a year from now? Because that's when the show's going to come out. And I think it is.
Yeah, definitely. Absolutely. It's a perennial. Claire, let me come to you next. Well, yeah. What are your favorite looks of Ellen's from the new series?
There was a green dress that we wore towards the end. Just one person inside the dress. green is one of my favorite colors anyway. And it was just, you know, when you find something that is just the right shade of just the right color. And so I think of everything, that was probably one of my favorites. And the dress I wore in the very first episode, Bex found such a wonderful dress in the first place, but then also such wonderful seamstresses. And it was tailored so well to fit me. And there's something about a dress that fits you just right that makes you feel incredible. There it is. That's the one.
The black one.
And yeah, the black one. Yeah. So that as well. Those two, I would say, were my favorites.
Incredible. And Rebecca, because we knew very little about Ellen at the start of the series, so what was your kind of brief in terms of her wardrobe?
They didn't actually give me a brief. They said, we'd love you to try different shapes on her and discuss with Claire how she would evolve. The thing I wanted, though, was that I wanted her to be quite minimal in her and not too much pattern. So it would be more blocks of colour and colours that would really sort of illuminate her. And the green is something that I love green on camera as well. But I paired her style down. So compared to Cinema, she didn't really wear pattern that much. And it was quite simple. I would do maybe use two colour blocks in one outfit. But apart from that, I would just sort of keep it to one colour.
Yeah.
Alexander McQueen, Suzanne Marge. Those are one of my favourite dresses. And she doesn't wear it that much, actually, is a Marge dress, which is a black tube with a white. It's very graphic. Graphic is a good way to describe her look, because it's simple and it's immediate.
Yeah, quite bold.
They're all so beautiful, these girls. That's anyway. Yeah.
Easy to dress, easy to make them look good.
Yeah.
And Daphne has some incredible outfits in Riviera, of course. So what were your favourite looks?
She does. Oh my God, where do I start? I love the two sheesh dresses that I wear. There's one that's very kind of twiggy vibes, quite 70s. There was a little mini dress with sort of purple with gold flowers. I think Daphne is a little bit of a magpie and she likes anything that sparkles. But I think that in this series, her wardrobe does evolve as she does as a character, and it's really reflected in what she wears. She also has this incredible Ralph Lauren dress that she wears in Argentina, which again is sparkly and kind of quite out there. And yeah, Beck spoilt us. She spoilt us with all the choices. It was heaven.
What was your favourite of Daphne's looks, Bex?
I really like the vintage Ralph Lauren, and a sheesh is always a favourite of mine. And there's a Gucci, because I did do some vintage buying. There was a Gucci when Tom Ford was designing for Gucci. Okay. And it's like a cut-out caftan, and you just wear nothing underneath it, and there's a vulnerability to it. So she's, you know, she's a chameleon. She's got so many different masks, and the clothes are her armour, really.
Yeah. I think we can see some of those outfits now. We have, is this the caftan that you were talking about?
No, sorry. No, that's a Silvia Tissarasi caftan, which is a Brazilian designer.
And this is the Ashish.
Oh, that's gorgeous.
Yeah, that's a good one.
She looks good in anything, though. Well, all of the girls do. Another Ashish.
Another Ashish?
Yeah, that one.
Yeah, really nice. It's quite a mood. Quite a mood. Quite much more than that for the Riviera.
I mean, what I really wanted was that I wanted the colours to change with Poppy a lot more, and it goes darker as the story continues through. Mm. So without giving too much of the story away, the colour palette changes along with her mood.
Yeah, perfect. So gorgeous. Now, there is still just about time to send your question in via the chat box. And just another reminder to use the hashtag SkyVIP when posting your Riviera-inspired outfits on social media. Last month, we gave you the chance to not only join us tonight and meet the cast, but also to join an exclusive party dressing masterclass with Grazia's fashion news and features director, Laura Antonia Jordan. Congratulations to three of our winners joining us live tonight, Helena, Anne, and Emma. Hello again.
Hello.
How are you guys?
Hi, guys.
Hello. Okay. Helena, I hear you've holidayed in Nice and Saint-Tropez. Is this what brought you to Riviera?
It is, and I think it's one of those that it's so beautiful. I was really fortunate to sort of get a helicopter from Nice over to Monte Carlo, and it was everything that you can imagine, the glamour and seeing the yachts and just seeing it. It's sort of got the whole package when you're watching that you're just transported there.
Yeah.
And then obviously beautiful, beautiful clothes all the characters are wearing.
Yeah, so dreamy. Anne, I hear you love the south of France as well. And I also hear you're a bit of a vintage fan. Tell us about your wedding dress.
Oh, my wedding dress was a beautiful Valentino black silk to the floor with just a cream bust. It was really lovely. Yeah.
Incredible. And you have a dress by Joan Collins, from Joan Collins.
I inherited an outfit from my grandmother that my uncle bought for her from the set of Dynasty.
Wow. Oh, my goodness. That is quite the vintage collection.
I'd love to see
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Emma, talking of wedding dresses, apparently you had not one but two. Tell us about your wedding dresses.
I wore Ian Stewart for both of them. We had to have two weddings. We had the legal wedding where I wore my little Ian Stewart dress, a little sort of tea dress style with the very beautiful appliques, lots of lace. And then for our illegal wedding, the day after, I wore a beautiful ball gown with lots and lots of beautiful crystals on, and the veil was custom made to match.
Wow, that sounds incredible. Full on Princess Bride.
Absolutely.
So Helena, coming to you next, because I hear you've got a bit of an eagle eye for spotting designer pieces on the show. Your question is a great one, and it's for Rebecca. So go on, what's your question?
Well, the question I've got is, each character's styles are all very different, but which one reflects closest your personality without all the styles?
My personality or their
personality. I think it's quite personal to you all, because they're all different styles, but then your personalities are all very different. So which one reflects your true personalities?
Well, I think as their actresses, you can't really, in their personal life, they all look very, very different. And I think I'd be doing a very bad job if I made them look like themselves. But I try, like I was mentioning earlier, to sort of carry the story arc along with what their clothes are like. I mean, I tend to like to use bold pieces just because I love fashion, but I think it's important to try to not let the clothes wear the actress. They have to be comfortable in it. It doesn't overtake a scene. I mean, it just adds to it rather than it enhances it. So I hope that answers your question.
I think it does. Poppy, do you feel like any of the clothes you wear in the show reflect your personality? Was there anything you wanted to take home? Oh, Poppy, can you hear me?
Sorry, guys. Someone on my laptop. That's really professional. I'm so sorry. I'm back.
No problem. Did you feel that any of Daphne's clothes from this series reflected your personality? Like, were there any that you wanted to take home?
Yes. I'd wear all of those looks in a heartbeat, honestly. And I kind of feel like we all would, and that's down to Bex being the genius that she is. But yeah, I would like all of them, please. Thanks. Really appreciate it.
Hint, hint.
Send you my address right after this, yeah.
Anne, coming to you next. Your question. Oh, go ahead.
No, you go. I think they, okay, they wear them in a different way. I just think, you know, they take it and they might wear one piece with a pair of jeans or something. I mean, you know, it's... Yeah, anyway, I'll shut up.
So, Anne, your question is for Julia, isn't it?
Yes, it is. Hi, Julia.
Hi.
Hi. Mine was, which of all the outfits that you've worn throughout the series is your favourite?
Oh, the whole series?
Wow. Yes.
I definitely, this last season, we just took it up a notch in terms of costumes and locations and drama. I had so many favorite outfits from this season, and I actually bought a lot at the end, and then we went into lockdown and I have nowhere to wear anything. I liked, not forget the dresses, I liked a lot of the to mix and match some of the smaller pieces. There were a few Victoria Beckham skirts and tops that I loved, and heels. I had some great heels. I bought a pair of kind of electric blue Victoria Beckham pumps, and they're just delicious and so comfortable.
Yeah. Amazing. Emma, coming to you next. Emma, who would you like your question to be directed to?
I think this is really for Rebecca, although I'd be really interested to see Julia's take on it as well from a production point of view. I want to know how you use fashion to reflect what's happening with the characters.
That's a difficult one to answer. I bet you Julia will be better at it. But you have to sort of think about how they're going to act in it, how they're going to move in it. For example, I can't really give the story away too much, but there's a dress that Julia wears when she's dancing in Buenos Aires. I don't really want to say, but it has to be strong. You have to be able to dance in it. She was feeling strident and willful. So that's how you have to take everything into consideration, and also the location and how it's going to look within the sets.
Julia?
I think one of the biggest challenges we have is that we'd have Georgina wearing an outfit that was, she'd be coming from somewhere, you know, in heels or in a very structured dress. And then the next scene, there would be a chase, or she'd be holding somebody at gunpoint and a lot of action. And all of a sudden she's not really dressed appropriately. So we had to balance the practicality and then also the glamorous looks. I think it's partially like wanting the color palette to reflect maybe the mood of the character or what they're going through, but then also the actual situation that they're in. And that's where the artistry comes in, I think.
Yeah, and the fantasy. It's amazing. Now, well, thank you so much, our fabulous Sky VIPs, Helena, Anne, and Emma. We have loads of questions coming through now from you at home. Yeah?
No, I was just, one of the things that is really interesting as well is, the clothes are stunning, but it's the little subtlety of the jewellery as well that reflects. And I know in I think it was either series one or two, and Georgina was just dressed very casually, but had a very simple Van Cleef necklace on. But it just, that stole the show rather than what the clothes were. So when you look at a piece, especially to Rebecca, when you're looking at a cloth, do you think of it as a whole picture, as in, you know, the jewellery that they're going to wear and which will outshine?
Yeah. Well, have you seen the poster for Riviera this year?
Yes.
I don't know if you have seen it. Well, I think the the icing on the cake, I mean, obviously it's a very strong orange dress, but what makes the dress stand out even more and Julia's face stand out even more is the, it's a little bit of turquoise. So you're absolutely right. You have to find your moment. You either use huge bits of jewellery and it just all looks very complicated. But generally, I like to use a gold cuff and then a simple hoop. And I do like simple jewellery that will make the outfit look better. So I think you're absolutely correct.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Now, we have loads of questions coming in, plus some from our competition runners-up. So here's one in from Emma Reed. How can I recreate these elegant and stylish looks without spending a small fortune on acquiring tailored and branded high fashion garments? I'll put that one to Rebecca.
I would strongly advise, well, the high street is the obvious answer. I mean, depending on how much money you have to sort of consistently go online and look at what the high street is doing. But if you, the trouble with the high street is they use very cheap fabrics. If you are prepared to go online and look at vintage clothes and then go to vintage shops, you will find some absolute gems. And because it's older fabric, it will last longer. And Stella McCartney has always been a huge fan of buying one expensive piece that will last you a lifetime. So that is also a good idea in the fact that you invest in one piece and it will last you forever.
Absolutely. Investment purchase. Big fan of that. So now let's hear from some of our runners up. First up, it's Perpetua Amu, who sent in this question.
How do you keep up the same dedication and enthusiasm in a third season?
Great question. Julia, how do you keep up the same enthusiasm and dedication in the third season?
It's not... difficult. It's not. It's such a fun show to work on. And it's, as I said, it's just getting better and better. I feel like this season, you know, we because Riviera is the title character that is that features heavily. But we also went to Venice, and then there's, you know, the conspiracy that Georgina gets sort of trapped in this season has tentacles all the way into South America. I don't know. It's not hard at all. It's a great group of people. I feel really lucky. It's a great job. And I feel a responsibility to make it as good as we can. And I'm lucky that the people that I work with are receptive to that. So I feel very creatively satisfied and challenged, and I get to travel to amazing places in the world. It's not hard at all.
Yeah, it's incredible. It's a great job. So we have a question in the chat box from Maxine. She says, Julia, if you didn't play Georgina in the show, is there another character that you would love to play? Interesting question.
Wow, that is a great question. Nobody has ever asked me that before. No, I can't even, I mean, I'm so in Georgina's head that I can't imagine being another character, but maybe like Cesar, like one of those super villains.
Yeah. Super villains, always fun to play, I imagine. Now we have a question from our second runner up, Amanda Binner, who sent in this question.
Hi. How do you get the balance between timeless classics and statement pieces to work for a particular scene? And do you get to see the whole script first?
That's a question for Rebecca.
Well, a timeless classic would be something like a really beautiful dress. For example, what Claire wears, it's timeless, it's classic, she looks beautiful in it. I think pieces like the Ashish, they are more defined for a certain period of time, whereas Claire's dress, you could put that back 10 years and no one would think twice about it, or at the beginning of the 90s. If it's appropriate, then it works. And if the actress feels good in it,
then it works.
Excellent. Thank you. Another question through on the chat from Sam, who says, do you have any time offset to explore the locations? We already know that Claire and Poppy, you went to the waterfalls. Did any of you get to go anywhere else? Shall I come to you, Julia?
I went to Melbourne.
Oh, just say that again, because it got fuzzy for a second.
Did you get to explore any of the amazing locations?
Yes, I try to take advantage of it as much as I can. I mean, the work is pretty intense, and the hour, you know, I'm in it every day. But the weekend, the one great thing about the French work ethic is that, or the French labor laws, is that when we're in France, we have full weekends because they don't want to do overtime. It's like illegal in France to do overtime. So we were given full weekends, and we have Saturday and Sunday to actually explore.
That's so French. I love it. The French know how to live, don't they? So we have a question from our final runner-up, Bindi Lal, who sent in this question.
Hi, my name's Bindi, and my question is, are all fashion items worn genuine designs or particularly designed around the needs of each storyline for each actor?
So I think what Bindi is asking there is if they're kind of existing designs or if they're specifically made. Now, we've talked about designers that you used throughout the show, but was anything specially made, Rebecca?
A couple of pieces were made for Cinema. Actually, one of them, here's me saying that you have to look at the location, and it was the same colour as the sofa, so she never got to wear it. We had to suddenly change because she just sort of washed into the sofa. So I made one piece for her, and that was about it, because I think the show as such is brand-led in terms of fashion, because people love the fashion. I tried to stick with the main fashion brands, but I would, if there was ever another season, I'd like to design some pieces myself.
Yeah, well, that would be amazing. We have one more question through on the chat from Mitchell, who says, what happens if costumes get ruined on set? Now, we talked about this a little bit before with the lots of different versions of the Gucci dress, but what happens if a costume gets ruined during a take?
Well, generally, you will have two of anything if you think it's going to get ruined. I mean, often there's nothing that you can do. Like when we were in Argentina, we only arrived with 150 boxes, which sounds like a lot, but it's not a lot. And you haven't got another day to go and find something. So you just have to be acutely aware and very, very on it, and woe betide my crew if anything happens to it.
Woe betide indeed.
Because they're going to get the wrath of Rebecca. I mean, you know, I look like quite happy and easygoing, but no, when I go, I go. So no, they just don't do that.
We also all have to change at lunchtime generally, otherwise we'll get in. There's the risk of spilling any of your lunch on your costume.
Yeah, I'm pretty bossy.
It's not worth the trouble.
No,
it's not worth the wrath of Beth. Yeah. Yeah.
No.
So we are nearly out of time, sadly. Rebecca the Velociraptor. We've got time for just one more. This is the last question. It's for Julia from Catherine. And she says, when considering Georgina's wardrobe, did you seek to set her apart from the rest of the Kleos family and their entitled wealth, providing some clue to her humble beginnings?
Yes, that's a great question. I think starting back in season one, there was very clearly, we wanted to have a contrast. We wanted to have a contrast between her and Irina, certainly, where Irina would be the very typical wealthy woman in the south of France who uses her, shows off brands as sort of a show off of her status. But it can be very cookie cutter, and we wanted Georgina in her fashion choices to show that she has a curator's eye, an artistic eye, maybe more of a specific, unique sense of design. And I think that carried over three seasons later.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, thank you so much. So that's all we've got time for, sadly, but thank you very much to Julia Stiles in Vancouver, Poppy Delevingne and Claire Hope Ashty, and of course Rebecca Hale back in Venice again, you lucky thing.
Ciao.
Thank you. Ciao, ciao. Thanks also to our competition winners, Helena, Anne and Emma, and the runners-up. We hope all six of you enjoy your makeovers. Mostly, thank you to Sky VIPs for joining us at home. Remember to keep sharing your social posts with the hashtag SkyVIP. And don't forget, Riviera is back for its most exciting season yet. Episode 1 is on air at 9 p.m. on Sky Atlantic and Now TV on the 15th of October. Good night from all of us here. It's been fantastic seeing you all. And here's a taster of what to expect in Riviera.
Gabriel Hirsch.
I know who you are.
I think we'd make a good team. I could use someone like you.
Nowhere to run. What did you think you were going to do when you took it? Nowhere to
hide. Do the Argentinians know? Leave it to me.
I'll get it back.
How does the mayor of Buenos Aires fit into all of this?
I run this city. It would be a dangerous mistake for you to stay in Buenos Aires.
I am in the middle of a political cover-up. You don't want to turn around and go home now, do you? Sometimes people push us too far. And our only choice is to fight back.
You must be so tired of running.